Good morning, church. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Let's all stand and worship the Lord together.
Sometimes you gotta dance in the darkness, sing through the fire, praise when it don't make sense. Sometimes you gotta stare down the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout it from the mountain, louder in the valley, trusting that he's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta wait for the wonder, wait for the answer, worship with your hands in the air. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give a praise, give a praise in the highest. Praise, give a praise, give a praise in the highest. Sometimes you gotta praise in the prison, cry out to heaven, shout into the door and swing wide. Sometimes you gotta stand on your shackles, brave in the battle, worship with your hands held high. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give a praise, give a praise in the highest. Praise, give a praise, give a praise in the highest. He is worthy, he is worthy of all of the praise. Give a praise, give a praise in the highest. Praise, give a praise, give a praise in the highest. He is worthy, he is worthy of all of the praise. Since day and night, countless reasons why I praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath, I praise you anywhere. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why I praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath, I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of your praise.
Good morning, church. Let's continue to stand and worship as we open our hearts for this next song.
Home, you were there and you're here right now.
strong and I've witnessed it. You're constant, I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. You save and I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again.
Man.
till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the devil's wounded tongue, and the angels stood in awe. Souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not fade, by its blood. We just praise you with everything in us. God, I pray that as we go into this time of learning about your word and what you've given to us, I pray that we would have open hearts and open minds to hear what Pastor Tyler is going to say to us. And we know that each of us are here for a reason. You have placed every person in this building in the very seat that they are sitting in. You have blessed it, and you have a word for them, and you are going to make them feel so loved and so seen, not just this morning, but as they walk out these doors and we get to celebrate the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, every day that we walk on this earth. I pray that that is the heart posture that we would just live in each and every day. We praise you and we thank you. In your name I pray, amen.
Good morning. Today we have something really exciting we get to do. I get to introduce you to Mark. So this is Mark coming up here, maybe. Nope, that's still me. This is not good. Mark looks better than I do. There it is. This is Mark. All right. Yes, Mark is one of our pastors here. He runs our sports ministry. Super nice guy. If you don't know Mark, do yourself a favor. Get to know him. He is awesome. Find an excuse to go talk to him. He is fantastic. But I realize now that I'm introducing you to the wrong Mark. Okay, I'm supposed to be introducing the Gospel of Mark. This is Pastor Mark. They're two different things. So just to clarify so that you don't get confused like I did, Gospel of Mark, Pastor Mark was the guy in the picture. The Gospel of Mark is the oldest of the Gospels. It was the first one written between 60 and 70 AD. Pastor Mark is the oldest person on staff. So there's a similarity, but here's the thing. Like, he's old, but he's not this old. Okay, he was only like 4 or 5 when this thing came out. That's not old enough to write it. Another big distinction between the two, Pastor Mark is super tall, Gospel of Mark super short, okay? It's 16 chapters, it's the shortest of all the Gospels. I told Mark I was doing this, so he's okay. The Gospel of Mark was written by a guy named John Mark. Pastor Mark's name is just regular Mark. So don't get confused with during the course of this series, Pastor Mark teaches us through the Gospel of Mark. They're not the same person. He is not the writer of it. But what we're going to do from now until Christmas Eve is we're going to slow walk through the Gospel of Mark. 9 months on 16 chapters as we seek to learn and grow in the knowledge of who Jesus is through the study of his teaching and through his life. And here's the thing. When you dig into the Gospels, they have this way of digging into you. And as you study and you understand and you begin to grow in your recognition of who Jesus is and how Jesus lived, it has this way of starting to mold and shape you into the image of Jesus, which is everything that we're about. The whole purpose of the Christian life is for us to know and grow in Jesus, for us to become like him as we follow after him in this world. And there's nothing quite like the Gospels to reinforce and help us understand how to do that. The Gospel of Mark was written during the Roman persecution of the church under Nero. Nero lit about a third of Rome on fire. People got really mad, so he needed a scapegoat, blames it on the Christians. And so Christians are suffering and struggling simply for their association with Jesus. And so he writes this gospel to encourage them, to offer them comfort and support by reminding them that Jesus struggled too. So in their hardship, in their struggles, they weren't alone. So what we're going to do as we kind of get into the Gospel of Mark, we're going to start in chapter 1. I know that seems like a weird place to start, but we're going to go ahead and begin at the beginning. And I want to set the stage for you to give you kind of an idea of the framework of the Gospel of Mark as we get into the text. So Mark chapter 1, verse 1, the beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Okay, let's hold on there. Mark identifies itself as a gospel. Gospel literally means good news. The New Testament begins with four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew and John are Jesus' disciples. So their Gospels consists of things that they saw with their own eyes, heard with their own ears. It's their own experience and expertise in their time with Jesus. Mark and Luke were not disciples of Jesus. So where does Mark's information come from? How is he the first guy to get the gospel of Jesus out if he wasn't even there for all the same things? Well, just like Timothy was the spiritual son of Paul, John Mark is the spiritual son of Peter. He spent a lot of time in Rome with Peter, who was one of Jesus' closest friends on earth, one of the inner three, the guy who gives the good confession, walks on water, sticks his foot in his mouth more often than he opens it. Peter. And so if you think of the Gospel of Mark kind of like a documentary, Peter is the source of information. He's the expert who knows the stories, and he's the one that's giving Mark the information. Mark's the author who writes it all down. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are referred to as synoptic gospels. Anybody want to guess or know what that means? So it's a library, right? Okay. It's okay to make noise in church. I know some of you guys are recovering Catholics, but you are allowed to talk. That's why we're not doing it in Latin, all right? Similar, yes, the synoptic gospels are gospels that look similar. It's a compound word, optic, as in optical, how things look. Syn, like in synonym, similar. The synoptic gospels look similar because they contain a vast amount of the same stories and teachings of Jesus, typically with Matthew and Luke going into a whole lot more detail than Mark does. Because Mark is an over-caffeinated squirrel, right? He writes his gospel, just like, and then, and that's just how it moves. 42 times in 16 chapters, he uses the word immediately. Okay, so Mark's the guy that woke up, had six Red Bulls, and is shaking in the corner going, guys, I can see colors and hear, well, you always see colors. I can hear colors. Wow, that's, apparently I need some of that Red Bull that he's had. Right, the other Gospels walk us through the life of Jesus. Mark does it in a dead sprint the whole way. Because he is so excited to tell us about who Jesus is. So excited for us to know the life and the teaching of Jesus that he just can't contain himself. And so it's just immediately. I like Mark. He's my speed. All right, you're laughing too hard at that. Shh. Go back to being a library. three of the Gospels are very similar. Each Gospel writer has a unique purpose and focus. Each Gospel writer has a unique thing that they want us to know and understand about who Jesus is, and each one reveals that to us in their genealogy. And one of the saddest things about modern society is we've lost all sight of the significance of that. Right? We do like ancestry.com to see how German or Irish we are or whatever it is. And we're interested in that. We're fascinated by that, but it doesn't really define us. It doesn't change us. It's just facts about us. Intriguing, but not transformational. Western society is actually very unusual in that. Most cultures, historically, are more communal driven. But as individualistic society, what we are is who you are is the summation of your actions and attitudes. It's just you. Nothing else defines you. Nothing else makes you anything. It's just that. But in communal societies, your identity, it doesn't just come from who you are. It comes from your family. It comes from your tribe. It comes from your nation. And so all these other things outside of just yourself influence and affect the kind of person that you were. In Jesus' day, they believed that character and quality were passed down in the blood. Psychologically, we call that nature. So if you had a grandfather who was a great leader, the expectation in the culture would be that you would naturally have strong leadership skills. Because who you are wasn't just about your individual identity, it was also about where you came from. And so when you introduced yourself, you didn't say, hey, my name is Jeff. You'd say, hey, I'm Jeff, son of John, son of James, son of Peter. You introduced your lineage so that people would better understand who you are. Matthew's genealogy consists of 26 names, tracing Jesus back to David. Pop quiz, what is David the archetype of? Oh, back to library, okay. He's a king. In the Jewish mind, he is the essential, ultimate pinnacle of what it means to be a king. And so when a Jewish person in the first century reads the Gospel of Matthew and they see this genealogy that goes back to David, the message that was undeniably clear to them is that what Matthew is saying is that Jesus is king. Luke's genealogy consists of 40 names. He traces Jesus all the way back to Adam. What is Adam the archetype of? I'm going to get all of you a Red Bull in a second here. Sorry? Son of God. Okay, Adam. Yes, son, man, humanity. What Adam represents is human. And so what Luke is teaching us about who Jesus is through his genealogy is that Jesus was a human, that he became man. John doesn't appear to have a genealogy until you look at what it says, and John 1 begins, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with him in the beginning, and through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was the light, and that light was the light of life, the light that shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. It doesn't sound like a genealogy, but what John is doing is he's tracing Jesus' origins not through human descent, but through divinity. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He jumped down to verse 14. He says he came to that which was his own did not receive him. But to those who did, he gave the right to become children of God. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. The Word that he's describing is Jesus. And so what John is telling us is that Jesus is God. Here's what Mark gives us. That's the whole thing. That's the birth narrative, that's the genealogy, that's everything that he tells us before Jesus' ministry begins. It's nothing. So in a society where who you are was defined by where you came from, and when you introduced yourself, you would introduce your father and your grandfather before you, what kind of person has no lineage? A servant. Four Gospels, four pillars of the core of who Jesus is, each one with a unique focus to show us, when you put them together, that Jesus is the God, man, servant, king. That's the full picture of Jesus. Mark's emphasis is on his servanthood. As Mark sat and listened to Peter talk, as he heard Peter share all the stories about Jesus, listened to all the things that Jesus did, what was fascinating to him, what stuck out to him above all other things, is that the God creator, sustainer of all life, came to the world as a servant. That the God who spoke the universe into being, from the tiniest of atoms to the vastness of the cosmos, came not as we would expect from a king or deity to be waited on and served, but rather he came to serve us. And that just, Mark could not get that idea out of his head. It was such an incredible thing. He was so focused on it, he couldn't. And so the definitive verse, kind of his dominant thought throughout his gospel, comes in chapter 10:45. Where it says, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. And so if the God, creator, king of the universe, came into the world not to be served, but to serve, how can we as his followers do any less? See, the gospel of Mark throws out this gauntlet to a challenge of holy competition. See, sometimes we act like, well, I'm just not a, everybody's competitive. We just compete in different arenas. What Jesus does is he changes the culture. He introduces us to an upside down kingdom, to a counterculture from the world around us, where the world around us competes by comparing ourselves to others. And it's about more, greater, and better. I want more power, more achievement, more success, more money. I want to have more influence, more ability. I want more rights to brag, because everything about the world is compare yourself to others, make yourself look better than others, have cooler stuff than others so that you can build yourself up. That's the competition of the world. What Mark does with his gospel is he says, no, we're the opposite of that. Our competition is not to build ourselves up. It is to lower ourselves down. It is not to sit at the top on the throne. It is to wash the feet of the people around us. And the competition of the Christian life is not to see which of us is the greatest. It's to see which of us can serve the most. That's the call of the gospel. And that's the lesson Mark wants to teach us. And one of the things that I love so much about the gospel of Mark is just is what his life says. See, some of you are here, and you look back at your past, and you feel guilt and shame because you've made mistakes, because you've done things wrong, because it's not perfect or sometimes not pretty. And even those of you like, I'm happy with where I am with Jesus now. Some of you kick yourselves for taking so long to get there. And what dominates really your relationship with Jesus is this overarching sense of guilt and shame. And so what you walk around with every day is this going like, man, can I really be useful to the kingdom of God? Could he really do something through someone like me? Because I am so broken and so messed up. And most of us on some level struggle not just with our effectiveness in the kingdom, but with the idea that God could really love us. Because when we look at our past, when we look at our lives, when we look at the mistakes we've made, we can accept that God offers grace to other people, but it's really hard for us to accept that that grace would apply to us. How could God love me after everything that I've done? And what the Gospel of Mark does is he looks right at that doubt, right at that feeling, and says, let me tell you why you're stupid for even thinking it. Let me tell you why you're absolutely wrong. Here's how Mark's ministry begins. He signs up to go on the first missionary journey with Paul and Barnabas. It gets hard. He gets scared. He bails and abandons them right in the middle of the work. Second missionary journey comes along. Mark's like, I want to try again. Paul's like, nope, not going to do that. I will not work with you. Ain't going to happen. Barnabas is like, come on, man, let's give him another shot. Paul's like, nope. And so the two disagree so strongly as to what to do with John Mark that they go their separate ways. Mark's ministry begins by quitting on the mission that he was called to and then dividing the dynamic duo. He's the reason the Beatles broke up and they're not going to make any more music. And he's got to live with that, knowing that the greatest ministry team that had ever existed at the time is now separated because of him. His ministry began as a failed follower of Jesus. That's a rough start. But he became a devoted disciple. He became a biographer of Jesus. He became a martyr for Jesus. And his gospel has influenced the lives of hundreds of millions of people. That's God's response to your insecurity. That's God's response to your doubt that you can be useful because of your past. God, with one exception in history, always uses imperfect vessels to carry out his perfect work. Your life isn't going to be perfect. Your walk with Jesus isn't going to be perfect. You're going to stumble. You're going to fall. We all do. But none of that disqualifies you from his service. None of that means that God cannot or will not work through you. See, John, he wants to show us that Jesus is more than just a teacher. He spends less time on the teaching of Jesus than any other gospel writer. Mark emphasizes the power, the authority, and the action of Jesus that you and I are called into. To walk in that authority, to walk in that power, that through him we are called to live and operate within the power and the mission of Jesus, to carry out his work. But here's the thing that we have to remember. Here's the thing that you need to know. It is not your perfection. It is his power that makes the difference. It is not how well you have always lived your life. It is not about you not making mistakes. It is not about you not stumbling. When you sit down with someone, it's not about you finding all the right words. It is not your perfection. It is not your performance. It is his power that makes the difference. And I can't tell you how freeing that is. Man, when you walk around thinking, man, if I say the wrong thing to this person, they're not going to get saved and go to heaven. Nope. That's not on you. It's not your perfection. It's his perfection. It's not what you can say and do. It's what he can say and do through you. That's the power of Mark's testimony. And so he just jumps in. No birth narrative. No genealogy. Just starts right off with the beginning of Jesus' ministry. So let's dive back in. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messengers before your face who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make right, make his paths straight." John appeared baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for forgiveness of sins. And all of the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and honey. Here's the question I have. Mark is so focused on getting into the story, he doesn't even bother to tell us that Jesus was born of a virgin. A supernatural birth seems kind of like an important detail to Jesus' life. He doesn't tell us that Jesus is born of a virgin. What he tells us is what John the Baptist is wearing. How is the dude's clothes more important than a supernatural birth? I'm so glad you asked. Hold on to that thought. We'll come back to it in a minute. John the Baptist is the beginning of Mark's gospel. Opens with John the Baptist. He is Jesus' cousin. He has come to prepare the way for Jesus after what's called a season of silence. That is, at the end of the Old Testament, we have a period of about 400 or 500 years where God did not speak to his people. There are no prophets. There's no prophecy. He just kind of left them to their own devices as a punishment for their unfaithfulness. John the Baptist brings that to an end. And so he shows up to prepare the way for Jesus. He's wearing camel hair by Prada. It's not that. It's not fancy. Okay, camel hair robes were worn by those in abject poverty. He wears a simple leather belt. In a culture in which your belt was a fashion piece, it was a statement. You people put a lot of time, they had big, gaudy, fancy belts. He says he's wearing like the simplest belt you can possibly imagine. Basically, it's like John the Baptist is walking around in a dirty, plain white t-shirt and old, wrinkly jeans. That's how he's clothed. And he's eating locusts and honey. That's not fancy, that's bugs. Okay? Listen, my dad is an entomologist. If you don't know what that means, I'm envious of your life. I would love to trade with you. Let's talk afterwards. An entomologist is a person who professionally studies bugs. Like, that's an actual job that people do. So if you're wondering what happened to me, that's part of it. Spent a lot of time having weird conversations about bugs. Entomologists don't just have a weird field of study. They have magazines. There are bug magazines that you get subscriptions to. Just the big cockroach on the cover, you know, 10 ways to lose fat now. They have conventions like Comic-Con, but for bugs. My dad took my mom to one. Didn't bother to tell her that at bug conventions, they don't just talk about bugs, they eat them. Yeah, she loved that. So she's sitting there having a casserole, not realizing that it's a caterpillar casserole. And then she's like telling the story. He's like, what? They're a good source of protein. You're like, I don't think you understand how people work. Okay? Bugs are a weird thing to have as a diet. And yet, Mark, who can't be bothered to tell us Jesus' lineage, who can't be bothered to tell us that Mary was a virgin and had this crazy birth, tells us what he's eating. Because it's not random. Everything that John the Baptist is doing, from the location of his ministry to his wardrobe to his diet, are done with an unusual intentionality. See, he's clothed himself in humility. Everything about his behavior is drawn to drive attention and focus away from himself. In a world where we have celebrity pastors who strut around like peacocks in the high-end fashion world with shoes that cost as much money as a normal person's house payment, all under the guise of being relevant, being cool, being connected to culture, drawing attention away from the gospel by placing it on themselves. What John the Baptist does is the opposite of that. Everything about it is moving attention away from himself. In fact, he is rejecting, in his wardrobe, in his diet, he is rejecting the self-serving materialism of his day. And if that doesn't strike close to home, he deliberately dresses himself like Elijah the prophet, who was famous for calling the nation to repentance. His ministry is in the wilderness. The wilderness is what Israel came out of after leaving slavery in Egypt. Everything he's doing is calling the people of God to repent, to turn away from the sinful culture of the world around them, and to live their lives focused on God. Verse 7. And he preached, saying, after me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Estimates are that up to 300,000 people came out to be baptized by John. That's a pretty booming ministry. Like, we do 20 at the Ocean, and it's like, I'm tired, I need to go to sleep. 300 is a lot. 300,000 is a lot. Here's why he was so effective. His method and his message were the same. What John the Baptist was doing was living out what he preached. So one of the things that drives me crazy about the religious Christian is that there are so many people today who walk around with Jesus' words on their lips, but not his love in their hearts. This is what drove Jesus crazy about the Pharisees. They knew the word really well, but the heart of God was not reflected in their lives. And if we're not careful, what can happen? And this is not meant to say we should not study and seek to know and grow in our understanding of Jesus. But if we're not careful, we can fall so in love with learning about Jesus that we forget to stop and actually live like Jesus. You want to be effective. You want your words to be impactful. Don't just declare. Demonstrate. And when the content of your life is consistent with the content of your lips, your words carry a whole lot more weight. John had a hugely successful ministry, but he never made it about himself. In fact, what he says, the mantra of his life is, he must increase and I must decrease. There is no simpler, clearer slogan for what it means to be a Christian than this. He must increase. We must decrease. If the focus of your pursuit of Jesus is yourself, then it's not Jesus you're pursuing. If the focus of your life is yourself, it's not Jesus you're pursuing. He must increase. We must decrease. Because what it means to be a follower of Jesus is that your life is all about Jesus. Despite the success that John was having, his purpose wasn't doing his own ministry. He's the wake-up call. He's the preparation. His purpose was to point people to Jesus. Church, that is our purpose. The call that Jesus has placed in your life, the work that he seeks for you to do, you're not here to change people. You're not here to transform the world. You're not here to save people. You're here to point them to Jesus. This is the calling of the Christian life. I've been in ministry for 20 years. I've never saved anyone. Now, by the grace of God, I may have been a vessel through which God brought someone to salvation, but it is his work, not mine, and we got to be real careful not to plagiarize his work. Jesus saves, not us. It's his power, not our performance. It's Jesus who does it. And the purpose of our life, by word and by deed, is to point people to Jesus. Verse 9. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and he was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately, there's one of Mark's favorite words, he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit descending like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased." The Spirit immediately, there it is again, drove him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild animals, and the angels were ministering to him. This is one of the greatest illustrations of just how jam-packed the Gospel of Mark is. So, firstly, primarily what we have here is Jesus' baptism, which he didn't do out of necessity. Baptism was done for repentance. Jesus has never sinned, so he has nothing from which he needs to repent. Jesus gets baptized to set an example as a demonstration of humility, obedience, and submission to God, and as a precursor to his serving as a substitutionary sacrifice on the cross for our sins. So we have the beginning of Jesus' public ministry, Jesus' baptism, heaven opens, the Holy Spirit shows up, God speaks from heaven, "This is my Son with whom I'm well pleased." Jesus goes out into the wilderness and is tempted by Satan. All that's five verses. Y'all think I talk fast? Like, that's so much content to try to cover. So Jesus has this baptism moment, this great moment with God, where the Holy Spirit shows up and his ministry begins. Here's the sequence: surrender, obedience, empowerment. The empowerment of the Holy Spirit comes after our surrender and obedience to Jesus. And then as soon as Jesus has this wonderful mountaintop high moment with his Father in the first biblical encounter with the Trinity, the Spirit leads him out into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And Mark doesn't tell us anything about what happened other than that it happened. If we want to know what happens to Jesus in the wilderness, which in the Jewish mind means doom and danger, we got to go to the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew tells us that Jesus was fasting in the wilderness for 40 days and he was hungry. In the biggest well-duh sentence in the Bible, Like, I go 40 minutes without food, I start getting cranky. 40 days, I've been dead for a month. Notice when the devil comes. It's not when Jesus is in the water. It's not when the Holy Spirit has descended down upon him. It's not when God is speaking in this voice of encouragement, "This is my son with whom I'm well pleased." It's when Jesus is alone in the wilderness after fasting for 40 days and being at one of the weakest points in his life. It's when he's weak and vulnerable that the devil shows up to tempt him. He tempts him three times. First, turn stones into bread. "Hey, you're hungry. Why don't you get some food?" Jesus says no. So he takes him to the top of the temple. He says, "Throw yourself down." This is a call to faith, right? God says he's not going to hurt you. If you believe God, if you trust God, prove it. Act according to that faith. Jesus says no. Takes him to the top of the mountain, says, shows him all the kingdoms of earth, says, "All this is mine. I'll give it to you. You bow down and worship me." This is the nastiest of the temptations, because it's a path to kingship without a cross. It's an option to receive the end goal without suffering along the way. It's an easy way out, a shortcut to completing his mission. And Jesus says no. Every time the devil tempts him, he quotes scripture. He does not, hear me, misquote scripture. He quotes it word for word. It is not what he says from God's word, but how he applies it that is wrong. I cannot emphasize this to you enough. Be careful who you let speak into your life. Be careful who you listen to. Be careful what online source you allow to inform your views and thoughts about God. Just because someone quotes scripture doesn't mean what they are telling you is accurate or consistent with the heart of God. It is so important for us not just know what the word says, but to understand what it means. Jesus' ministry began with surrender, with obedience, and then with struggle against the devil. Your service of Jesus will follow that exact same path. So when you experience that struggle, when you experience that hardship, the important thing that we remember, the important thing that we remind ourselves is that's not unusual. That means we're moving in the right direction. Because if you aren't moving with God, if you aren't serving God, if you aren't working for God, he has no reason to mess with you. It is not the attacks of the devil that should concern us. It is the absence of those temptations, the absence of those attacks that should make us worried. But if you're sitting still, he's got no reason to. But what happens after? Obedience, temptation, ministered to by angels. Don't quit during the struggle and miss out on the comfort that follows it. Don't give up in the season that is hard and miss out on the fulfillment that comes from it. Mark writes this letter to Christians who are hiding in catacombs amongst the dead because following Jesus was a death sentence. To tell them that in your struggle, in your suffering, in your temptation, you're not alone. Jesus struggled, Jesus suffered, Jesus was tempted, and Jesus held fast. And because he was victorious over those things, through him we can be victorious over those things. And as Mark writes, what he wants to share with us, the hope that he wants to give us, is that we have a Savior who suffered and served for us. As he listened to Peter tell the whole story of who Jesus was, all the teachings, all the life, what stuck out to him so intently was that Jesus was a servant. And that the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And the question that we ask is, are we going to be known the same way? See, it's easy to say, "I follow Jesus." It's easy to say, "I believe in him." It's easy to call yourself a Christian. But when people tell the story of our lives, will the striking detail about them be the same as it was about Jesus? If the Son of Man was known as the guy who came not to be served but to serve, will we be known as those who came to serve? You see, in his service, he laid down his life as a sacrifice for many. Not focusing on himself, what was good, what was easy, what was comfortable, but as people. So today we're going to take communion together. If you believe, if you didn't get one of these on the way in, you can raise your hand. We've got some people that are going to run down. They can drop them into your hand. So just make sure you hold it up high enough for them to see it, because there may be someone taller than you behind you. In case you're in front of Pastor Mark, they won't see you. But this is the ultimate depiction of what the service of Jesus looks like. What the sacrifice of Jesus looks like as he laid down his body, as he laid down his life for us, that we would be strengthened and empowered through him to live as servants of his kingdom, seeking not our own comfort, but his glory. So as we take this together, let's remember where it's from. And the cup of his blood, the life that was shed for us. This is the power in our imperfection. This is the power that brings transformation, the blood, the life of Jesus. And the hope that even in our wildest imperfection, he does great things through us. Let's take it together. Heavenly Father, God, we praise you for who you are. That though you are the least who should ever serve, that you should never have been the one to wash feet, never have been the one to stoop down, that you are more worthy of praise and adoration than any, that you came to serve us. God, may that transform us. That we would never get so focused on ourselves, our comfort, our own egos, that we become too big or too great to follow your example. And just as your Son was characterized by service, may our lives be characterized by the service of you. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for grace. Amen.
Amen, church. Let's stand and respond.
There's only one way.
Jesus is coming back. This is our hope.
He is surely coming. Oh, can you feel it too? All this tension growing stronger. It's just a sign he's getting closer. He's already on the move. Amen. Yeah. Oh, the story has been written. We all know how it is. Yes, we do. My future has an anchor.
Thank you. We thank you for the example of Christ, who came to be a servant, who came to die for us. I pray that we look to him every day, not just Sundays, Father, but every day when we're witnessing to people, not just by words, but by actions. I pray that you empower us to do your will, to follow your word every day. In Jesus' name, I pray these things. Amen. Thank you so much. If you'd like someone to pray with, find a team member with a green tag, and they'd love to pray with you. We'll see you next week.